many companies are seizing on the digital revolution to entirely reimagine not only their customer experience, but also to redesign entire swathes of their operations.
Access Bank is one of those that's revolutionising the way its branch staff operate. By automating simple tasks, staff are freer to explore more value-added services. The bank is developing what it terms the branch of the future, as well as rethinking customer journeys via its app.
It certainly is, and the digital push is working. Get this, 60% of new personal loan disbursals in the most recent quarter were entirely digital. Well, I'm delighted to say we're now joined by Sameer Shetty. He's President and Head of Digital Business and Transformation at Access Bank. Sameer, it's good to see you. Thank you so much for being part of Cyboss TV. I mean, look, 60%, really impressive. So given that, how do you see digital transforming the business?
Thank you, and thank you for having me here. I think the impact of digital in financial services in general is very, very significant. In India in particular, financial services businesses are both impacted as well as benefiting from the digital revolution. For us, digital impacts us in three different ways. The first is launching more and more new direct-to-customer digital propositions, which can generate new business for us and new revenues for us. And particularly here, the theme that we are most excited by is the sachetization of financial services. So, you know, earlier in the physical world, it was impossible for us to give small ticket financial service products. Today, in fact, we give loans which are approximately $7. Our smallest ticket size of a loan today is $7. And we are able to do this because we are able to, you know, in the digital world, reach our customers with a very different operating efficiency, as well as we are able to take out a lot of friction from this. And the sachetization allows us to cover a very large number of customers that we earlier could not have gotten to. So that's one theme. The second theme that we are very excited by is the emergence of ecosystems. In the physical world, let's say if you wanted to, you know, take an international trip, you would first have to go to a travel agent, book your ticket. You'd have to go to a bank, take a loan to fund that ticket. You'd have to maybe go to another bank and take some forex. You'd have to go to an insurance company and buy the, you know, kind of travel insurance. Today, all of this happens on one place and in one, you know, digital property, right? Like you can book your ticket, you can get a loan there itself. You can get your forex there itself. You can get insurance there itself. And this emergence of ecosystems, which makes financial services invisible, is a second big theme that we are very excited by and we are working towards. The third big theme is basically the centrality of customer experience. So I jokingly say that, you know, earlier, if we had an hour-long discussion on any topic, for the first 59 minutes, we would discuss, you know, compliance, risk, and the like, and the last 1 minute would be dedicated to customer experience. In the new world, this world has turned topsy-turvy, and so, you know, customer service and customer experience has become central to every discussion and every feature and every product that we release. So these three themes, I would say, are kind of central to us as we think of digital and the evolution of digital space in the world.
What do you see as competitive advantage in this space, Sameer, considering the fact that everyone is investing?
No, fantastic question. And I think we have a very clear view here, which is that if we have to win in the digital space, we have to be a digital native organization. What does that mean? So 10 years back, if you'd gone to banks and asked them, would they outsource their, you know, branch managers, or would they outsource their risk department, or would they outsource their best private banking relationship managers? The answer would be a clear no. And hence, I think 5 years from now or 7 years from now, banks cannot, or any institution cannot, survive in the digital world if they are outsourcing their design, if they are outsourcing their technology development, if they are outsourcing their analytics. And so this, in our mind, the build of the digital native capability is core to competitive advantage. And hence, over the last 2 years, we've invested very significantly in this space. So as an example, we now have a team of about 800 people who are focused exclusively on the digital agenda. We have a team of approximately 200 member engineering team, which is an in-house team. And it's a full stack team. So we have front-end developers, back-end developers, DevOps, and so on and so forth, who are building technology for the bank. We have about a 200-member analytics team, which is looking at the data and creating insights. We have an in-house design team, and every digital property of ours is now designed in-house. And we've built our entire CI/CD stack so that we can deploy continuously, and we can do this on the cloud, and we are becoming 100% cloud native. This capability to be able to build products, launch them rapidly, and to do it in a very iterative fashion, in our minds, is what is going to differentiate winners from, you know, kind of the others. And hence, a lot of our investments are towards this direction.
And Samir, we know that India itself as a country has seen the powerful build-up of digital infrastructures as public utilities. But what does this mean for digital adoption in the country as a whole, and specifically for businesses like yours?
I think what India has seen in the last 5 years is nothing short of a miracle. So as an example, I think 5 years back, about 40 or 50% of the country had a bank account. Today, actually, the number of accounts is more than the number of people in the country. So, you know, our banking penetration has, it's close to 100%. India launched something, and by the way, this was made possible by what is called the Jam Trinity. There was a program called Jandan launched by the government. There was Aadhaar, which is the digital identity solution that again has been launched by the government. And mobile, which is, you know, putting everything on the mobile app. So digital was in the center of this. Similarly, India launched something called UPI a few years back. UPI is a way for Indians to transfer money from, you know, any bank account to anybody. So, you know, you can just put somebody's phone number and transfer money to them. It'll reach them. And this transfer happens in, you know, real time, which means in under 2 seconds or 3 seconds, I'm able to transfer money to you. And it happens at zero cost. So there is no cost to the customer as well. What this has done is that in the last month, there were more than 3 billion transactions that happened via UPI. And so, you know, that in itself is a mega and a mammoth number, right? That has happened. And this has happened at no gain to any private enterprise. This is all public utility. So this is all free of cost for the consumers. And, you know, that kind of nobody, the benefit of this goes to the consumer. It doesn't go to any private institution. Recently, India launched something called the Account Aggregator. So as a consumer, I can share my data available in any bank with any other institution based on consent. This data sharing is fully regulated, and hence there are very clear privacy norms around what that data can be used for, how much time can it be kept, and so on and so forth. And so it has made the ability of consumers to use data for their benefit versus, you know, earlier data was the ownership of entities. And again, this kind of transfers power from corporations and entities to individuals. So what Account Aggregator will do, it's very early days, but what Account Aggregator will do is democratize finance, just like it democratized financial inclusion through UPI. Account Aggregator will democratize availability of credit for individuals. And so these are all powerful building blocks. And again, the most important point is that this is not with any private entity. There is no entity which owns this data. There is no entity which is running UPI. It's all public infrastructure. And so it does two things. One, for banks, obviously, there is a threat that our margins kind of fall. And, you know, we are data, as an example, that was available only with us yesterday, will tomorrow be available with everybody, obviously with the consent of the customer. But also it's an opportunity for us to fundamentally reimagine how we do underwriting and how we can underwrite a large number of customers who we could not have done earlier, or how we can open accounts for a very large number of customers who we could not have done earlier. Just as an example, we have a fully digital account opening a product and we are doing very, very reasonable numbers through that. The cost of opening that account for us is half of what we would do in the physical channel. And I think that kind of benefits is what this infrastructure buildup entails for financial services businesses.
What's the scale at which digital's impacting your business, Samir? Can you give us an idea of some numbers?
So digital is very, very significant for us. Over 70% of our customers are active on either our mobile app or our internet banking portal or any of the digital channels. We have approximately 8 million monthly active users on our mobile app. They come to our app approximately 10 to 11 times a month. 73% of our deposits are generated fully digitally, which means there is no middleman. Consumers go to our mobile app and kind of get it. 60% of our personal loans are disbursed, new personal loans are disbursed fully digitally. 75% of credit cards are done fully digitally. 60% of new mutual fund sales are happening fully digitally. Approximately 40-45% of our Forex sales are happening fully digitally. And so on and so forth. The list is endless, right? So whether you take transactions, by the way, 90% of our transactions are fully digital. I don't include ATMs, by the way, in digital, right? So ATMs and branch are outside, and 90% of that is fully digital. So it's a huge list, and the impact is already significant, and we only see this time over time.
It is a huge list, but you know, you were able to give us so much in that answer, and we are so grateful to you for that. Look, Axis is on an exciting journey. We wish you well going forward into the future. But Sameer Shetty, who's the President and Head of Digital Business and Transformation at Axis Bank, thank you so much for giving us your time. And, well, enjoy Cybels 2021. It's been a pleasure speaking with you.